Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab for Digital Feedthrough in Precision DACs. In this video, we will discuss the meaning of digital feedthrough. Then we will describe some sources of digital feedthrough and review some strategies to reduce it. First, let's answer the question, what is digital feedthrough? Essentially, digital feedthrough is when a digital input to a precision DAC causes undesired glitches on the output of the DAC. For example, this plot is from the DAC 80508. We can see that the S-clock signal on the SPI bus causes spurs or glitches on the output. Some devices have digital feedthrough specified in the electrical characteristics table. Some digital feedthrough is unavoidable on devices as it is caused by some element inside the design of the IC itself, but a majority of digital feedthrough sources are external and controllable. Now let's discuss some causes of digital feedthrough. The layout of key analog connections and digital connections in the PCB is the first external cause of digital feedthrough that we will discuss. Here is a simplified diagram of a DAC's PCB layout. We can see that there are digital inputs to the DAC that come from a digital source, such as a microcontroller. There is a reference input from a reference source, and there is an analog output that goes to some other analog input. It is important to consider that all physical mediums in electronics can have undesired properties. For example, traces in parallel will have some capacitive coupling, allowing charge to flow from one to another. In addition, parallel traces may have some inductive properties, allowing a transformer to form between them. In this example, you might have capacitive and inductive coupling between the digital lines and the analog lines. This can result in digital feedthrough as the fast edges of the digital line produce charge on the analog lines. This feedthrough is now found on the DAC directly, and glitches on the reference will be translated to the DAC output as well. Another path where digital noise can be fed through the DAC is the power supply pins. Systems where the power supply is shared between the digital source and the DAC, or in systems where the digital lines are routed near the analog supply, can have greater digital noise or glitches in the power supply pin. As many components within the DAC, such as the output buffer, the reference, and the reference buffer, all have limited power supply rejection, it is possible for supply transients or noise to be seen on the output as well, though usually at a lower magnitude. In this case, the digital communication would create a transient on the supply, which is then seen on the output. This behavior can be quantified by looking at the power supply rejection ratio, which is specified on some DACs. Another source of digital feedthrough can be found when we look how a DAC is grounded. Let's consider a device that only has a single ground pin. This ground pin will act as the return current path for both the analog blocks of the IC, such as the reference, reference buffer, resistor ladder, and output buffer, and the digital blocks, like the SPI or I2C interface. The problem this might present is that the pins on any IC usually have some series resistance. This resistance is a byproduct of the very thin connections used in the design. It can be found in the actual layout of the die, the bond wire that connects the die to the package itself, and finally the PCB layout. As a circuit designer, there is very little you can do to reduce the resistance that is found inside the device, but the PCB layout is under your control. This series resistance, shown as R series, can create a slightly higher potential for the local ground level, shown as V ground local, depending on the current that is flowing through it. The problem that can be presented during operation is that the digital inputs can have short periods of higher input current during an edge transition of the digital line. That current, shown as I digital, must flow to ground, and will use the path provided by R series. When we look at the current transients coming from the digital input, we should see an appropriate potential change on V ground local. The issue is that the reference voltage and resistor ladder ground, sometimes referenced to as Vref minus or Vref negative, now has the same glitch. This glitch will be reflected in the output. Some devices have a separate digital ground pin and analog ground pin, which helps reduce this issue. But even in those devices, poor PCB layout can still allow digital feed-through to occur. Now that we have discussed the most common sources of digital feed-through, let us talk about some of the strategies we can implement to reduce it. First, we can consider how to improve the PCB layout to reduce the capacitive and inductive coupling between the analog and digital signals. Here we can see the original layout that we used as an example earlier. Some simple routing changes would allow the analog traces to have more distance and less capacitive coupling to the digital traces. By routing the digital around the analog traces, we have improved the digital feed-through of the design. Now let's talk about strategies to improve the digital feed-through caused by noise being found on the power supply pins. The best way to do this is to have a good supply decoupling scheme. Ideally, capacitors are useful in filtering high-frequency components of signals because their impedance reduces at higher frequencies. If this was the case, a single capacitor would be all that is required for good filtering. The problem with a real capacitor is that they also have a series inductance. At higher frequencies, this element begins to dominate, and the capacitor does not filter noise anymore. The actual impedance of a real capacitor would look more like this. So a single cap might not be enough to remove all the higher frequencies that might be present in a system. Using multiple capacitors with different values can add additional coverage on certain frequencies. When these are all in parallel, your total impedance might look something like this. These capacitors in parallel now provide a wider band of frequencies in which they will filter noise. Another decoupling strategy is to create an actual low-pass filter. A small series resistance along with a decoupling capacitor can create a simple filter that will remove higher frequency components from the supply. While this is a good strategy, it can present some problems depending on the supply current that is required by the DAC. The series resistance will create a voltage drop on the supply pin that corresponds to the current that is flowing through the device. Sudden current draws can also cause transients on the pin that would cause something that actually looks like digital feed-through. For this reason, the resistor value must be small to reduce the voltage drop. That'll increase the cutoff frequency of the filter. The final decoupling strategy to reduce the digital feed-through relies on a series inductor, generally a ferrite bead, to filter some of the high-frequency components of the power supply. An inductor behaves as a short at low frequencies, but its impedance will increase at higher frequencies. The only drawback to this strategy is that most beads have an effective impedance at fairly high frequencies, generally in the tens to hundreds of megahertz. Most precision DACs do not have digital interfaces that operate at this speed. It is effective in removing the high-frequency clock signals that might be found connected to the microcontrollers or switch-mode power supplies in the system. These decoupling strategies can be combined to create a very robust noise filtering system, as shown here. Here, we are leveraging a series ferrite bead, an RC filter, and multiple capacitors in parallel. Finally, let's look at some strategies to reduce the series resistance in the ground path. As we discussed earlier, some of the series resistance cannot be controlled by you as it is integrated in the device, but series resistance caused by PCB layout can be reduced by implementing good layout practices. Here we have two example layouts. On the left, we see a device with a digital ground pin and an analog ground pin. They are connected to each other with a trace that then connects to a single via to another plane, usually a ground plane. The issue with this layout is that the segment of trace that they both share and the via itself have a series resistance. The return current from the digital ground pin can now create a slightly higher potential for the analog ground pin. On the right, we see a PCB layout where there is no ground plane. Instead, the return ground trace is routed from the analog ground to the digital ground to the supply source.
Similar to before, this section of trace has a series resistance. The return current to ground will create a potential across that resistance and bias the analog ground to a higher value. Let's see how we can improve this layout. On the left, we see that rather than sharing the same via for both analog ground and digital ground, we have created a dedicated via for each of the two pins. For starters, the shorter trace would result in lower series resistance. In addition, the digital return current path is not the same as the analog ground path. This means that even if there is a higher potential due to series resistance, that potential is not seen by the analog ground pin. Now let's look at the right side. Here we have changed our device placement. The routing order is such that the digital ground pin is connected to the analog ground pin and then connected to the supply ground. Now the return current from the digital ground shares a minimal path with the analog ground. This minimizes the series resistance seen on the analog ground pin that shares the same digital current return path as the digital ground pin. This will result in a lower potential seen on the analog ground pin. Okay, so in conclusion, the primary causes of digital feed-through are the following. Capacitive and inductive parasitics on the PCB layout between digital and analog signals, digital noise carried into the DAC through the power supply, and series resistance on the DAC ground that digital return current must pass through. These problems can be minimized by geographically separating the digital signals and the key analog signals during PCB layout. It can also be minimized by filtering high-frequency noise on the DAC power supply by using a good supply decoupling scheme. And finally, reducing series resistance on the ground pins of the DAC by using short and direct ground connections and by separating digital return paths from analog return paths can also reduce it. Okay, now let's do a short quiz to check our understanding of digital feed-through. Question 1. What are the primary causes of digital feed-through of a precision DAC? Select all that apply. Is it A, PCB layout allowing capacitive and inductive coupling between the digital lines and the analog lines? B, shared ground current return paths between the digital and analog portions of the DAC that have high series resistance? C, internal resistor ladder switching adding glitches to the output? And D, power supply noise is being added to the DAC output. The answer is A, B, and D. C is not a valid cause for digital feed-through. The internal resistor ladder switching added glitches to the output might be a cause of code-to-code glitch, but not digital feed-through. Question 2. True or false? A good PCB layout can reduce digital feed-through. This was an easy one. The answer is true. A good PCB layout is the first step to reducing digital feed-through. Question 3. Which of the following is not a good power supply filter? The answer is C. While this circuit will act as a low-pass filter and remove noise, the high resistor value could cause a significant voltage drop on the pin as current flows into the device. This lower supply voltage could potentially cause brownout or reset events. Okay, that concludes this TI Precision Lab about digital feed-through in precision DACs. Please find more precision DAC technical resources and search our products by visiting ti.com/pdac. Thank you for watching.